myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak, would you pour down my grave, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your. In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you. And in the quiet, I hear your voice, word of God speak. In the loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Depths of Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning, bringing us to church so we can fellowship with other children of God. Please open our hearts and our minds to the message that Pastor Scott has for us and help us apply it to our everyday life to be more like Jesus. We ask these things and all things in your Son's precious holy name. Amen. Church, have a seat. Excuse me. Good morning, Bridge Church. Good morning, visitors. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Glad to see everybody here this morning. First off, we'd like to reiterate or announce, we need to fill out our connection cards, people. We want to know about you. We want to know that you're here. We want to know your needs, your prayer requests, what service you come to, and just want to get a pulse of the church. So please fill out your connection cards that you would have gotten from the ushers. Or if you didn't get one, please stop at the connection table in the back. The next announcement would be, if you're new to the Bridge, we have what we call Stick Six. It means you stick around for six services, and by that time, everyone is saying you should know that you want to be here. I'm saying you'll know after a week, two at the most. With the people that we have here, feel welcome, you're part of the family, and you just want to be around us on as a church family on Sunday. So you can use the Stick Six, but like I said, it'll take less than that. In the event that you want to become a member, we do have new members classes, a one-on-one class that you get a chance to sit with the pastor in a more intimate setting, get to know him, get to know the vision that he has for the church, the direction that we're going into, and the positive things that we're doing in the community. The next class that we have, I believe, is May the 5th after the third service. So if you're interested, fill out your connection cards. You can put the information on there, or you can download the church app and put in the request there. Keeping on that same first steps to becoming a part of the church, we do have a new small group called Cozy with Christ. Thank you, Crystal. It is with our great Grant and Taylor. They host it. It's for young people 18 to 30. You have to be 18 to 30. You can't look that age. So they're checking birth certificates. So, no, it's just with that couple just being married and their journey as individuals and as a young couple in Christ, it's a great start for young people to understand a great foundation in your journey and your walk with the Lord. So you can sign up for that on the church app as well. We do have some April events. The 27th is a baseball game to come out and fellowship to go see the Quakes. So come on out. It's a good time to just let your hair down. Of course, I don't have any, but kind of hang out with the church family and watch a baseball game. It's a good, fun time for the family. Also, speaking of family, on the next day, the 28th, is our family Sunday. It's our family Sunday. There we go. There we go. See, sorry, guys. New people, they're usually more riled up about this. I don't know what it is today, but we do have a good time on our family Sundays. You can come on out. It's good food, good fellowship. Just a good time outside the sanctuary. They have games for the kids. They have sweets. And it's just a good time to fellowship outside the sanctuary. So please, if you can, come on out and enjoy yourself. Other than that, I don't have anything else. So kids, you guys are released. And everyone else, welcome somebody to church.
Good morning, Bridge Church. Let us take our seats. Let's get into God's Word. I am excited to get into Daniel this week, chapter 2. I was excited last week just to get into the book of Daniel. Now, this week, we're going to get into some of the more difficult stuff in this book. And what I mean by that is I'm talking about the prophetic dreams and the interpretations and the predictions. People have discussed and argued and fought about some of the words that we're going to read today for generation upon generation. Even before Jesus came to earth, people were discussing and arguing about some of these dreams and these prophetic meanings and what everything meant from the dream we're going to read today. Now, I saw this book called Predictions for the Next Millennium. And these predictions are all from celebrities. Yes. Are you guys excited for the celebrity predictions? These are politicians, statesmen, musicians, and actors, okay? And they predict in this book what is going to happen over the next 1,000 years. So let's see if we might agree with some of these celebrities. The first one, we will all have a common language and a common currency within 1,000 years. What do you guys think? Could that happen? Okay, next one. A world government that will heal the planet. Good luck. And this last one here. The Earth's politicians will be taking interplanetary economic lessons from alien beings to find out how to cooperate and operate a government without taxing people. So listen, knowing the future, predicting the future, interpreting dreams, this has always been very, very popular right from the beginning. Now, Daniel chapter 2 is all about prophetic dreams and the interpretation of them. And today I'm going to give you some certainties about your future even. We will get there later. Now, to set the stage, to give you some context, the book of Daniel tells a story about Israelites who were taken captive and sent into exile. And the biggest, baddest empire the world had ever seen, the Babylonian Empire, came knocking on Jerusalem's door and took over the city. They destroyed it, even burned the temple to the grounds. Now, last week we learned that they didn't just destroy it, they took a whole wave of some of the ruling elites and the upper class with the intent of not only destroying their present, but also destroying their future by making the best of the best Israelites and making them Babylonian leaders. In chapter 1, we learned about 4 different Israelites, in particular, Daniel and his friends, who had also been hauled off around 1,000 miles away to Babylon to be indoctrinated, given new names, new language, new clothes, new food choices that they didn't want, with the sole purpose of making them like the culture around them, to sound like, to behave like, to think like, to believe like the Babylonians. Now, this is an extremely powerful book because it's all about the challenge that God's people have had for most of history. How do we maintain our faith while living in the culture around us? How do we maintain our identity in Christ in a society that is not very Christ-like? How do we maintain our integrity? How do we actually engage with the culture around us without compromising our convictions as people of God? And this should not come as a surprise for us, because the Jesus movement started as a small minority movement. And everyone thought that they were crazy. And everyone thought that they were weird and disruptive and eventually even persecuted to the point of death, being killed by governing powers. God's people, wherever they have been throughout history, have had to maintain this minority mindset. Now, let me ask you this question. Has anyone here ever been on a lazy river? The lazy rivers at pools, fancy pools, or at water parks, where you just kind of sit there and it takes you under waterfalls and you can sit on a little floaty and go around for hours if you want to go. Has anybody? Right, I saw a couple hands. I think most of us have seen at least a lazy river. Okay, have you ever tried to swim the other way on a lazy river? Anybody try that? Yes, come on. If you haven't tried that, you should. It's very difficult. It's kind of fun. A lot of people around you going the other way are going to get mad at you, but it's okay because you're trying to swim the other way. Now, this is a lot like living as a Christian in this world and culture, because it kind of always feels like we're swimming upstream against the current. Because God has called us to live this different life and in turn makes us this counterculture. And people might yell at you even on this path, right? Going against the current. Like you're going the wrong way. And you're saying, no, God has called me to live this way on the lazy river. Now here's the deal. You can resist the current of the lazy river, but eventually you're going to get tired. Your body's going to kind of burn out, and for some of us, that might be 30 seconds. Others, maybe a couple minutes. It takes an immense amount of effort to swim against the lazy river current. It takes no effort whatsoever just to relax and let the current just take you along, and you just get carried along, just like we can get carried along in our culture. And just swim down this lazy river in the culture. That's the dynamic in the challenge that the book of Daniel opens for us. How do we swim against the currents of this culture? Because being a Christian is difficult. When following Jesus becomes comfortable for me, I know that I'm probably not following Jesus anymore. Because to actually live by the teachings of Jesus and to follow him and to do it together as a community means that we swim against the currents with everything, with our time, with our money, with our value systems, with how we treat people, with what we think about. Every part of our lives should be reshaped by God. And it takes no effort whatsoever just to float along with the culture and get carried along the stream. But it takes immense effort to keep swimming against the stream. And so it raises the question, what's going to motivate us? What's going to motivate you to give you energy for a lifetime of fighting against the currents of the culture that we find ourselves in? And that's what the book of Daniel opens for us as we turn to chapter 2. Now, we're going to read a lot of scripture today, and that's okay, because it's God's word. I didn't want to take out a bunch of stuff. I want you to read with me what this looks like and what Daniel was going through. So here we go. Daniel chapter 2, 1 through 4. Sorry, 1 through 5. In the second year of his reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His mind was troubled, and he could not sleep. So the king summoned the magicians, enchanters, sorcerers, and astrologers to tell him what he had dreamed. When they came in and stood before the king, he said to them, "I have had a dream that troubles me, and I want to know what it means." Then the astrologers answered the king, "May the king live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will interpret it." The king replied to the astrologers, "This is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me what my dream was and interpret it, I will have you cut into pieces and your house is turned into piles of rubble." So this guy wakes up and he needs some coffee. He needs some coffee. He's waking up. He just give him a break. I mean, don't we all, when we show up to church, if the coffee's not out there, aren't you going to say, "I will cut you to pieces," if we don't have that cup of coffee? Now, what would you do in this situation, if you're one of these guys? Imagine yourself working for the head of a country or whatever, and he's not the sharpest tool in the shed, and he tells you to interpret his dream. Even if you thought this guy was completely incompetent, He threatens you with cutting you into pieces. Would we all not say, your dreams are awesome, Lord. May the king live forever, right? We'd probably be doing that because we don't want to be cut to pieces. So that's some of the context. Let's keep going. But if you tell me the dream and explain it, you will receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor. So tell me the dream and interpret it for me. Once more they replied, let the king tell his servants the dream and we will interpret it. Then the king answered, I am certain that you are trying to gain time because you realize that this is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me the dream, there is only one penalty for you. You have conspired to tell me misleading and wicked things, hoping the situation will change. So then tell me the dream, and I will know that you can interpret it for me. The astrologers answered the king, there's no one on earth who could do what the king asked. No king, however great and mighty, have ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among us. This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all the wise men of Babylon. If you were here last week, what status was Daniel and his friends elevated to at the end of chapter 1? Uh-oh, okay, we have a problem here, because they were elevated to the station of the wise men and the counselors to the king. So all of a sudden, Daniel, who hasn't even appeared in this story yet, his life and the life of his friends are now in danger. So the decree was issued to put the wise men to death, and men were sent to look for Daniel and his friends to put them to death. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, had gone out to put to death the wise men of Babylon, Daniel spoke to him with wisdom and tact. He asked the king's officer, why did the king issue such a harsh decree? Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. At this, Daniel went into the king and asked for time so that he might interpret the dream for him. Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged them to plead for mercy from God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. And now this gets important here. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven and said, praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons. He deposes kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what lies in darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank and praise you, God of my ancestors. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we asked of you. You have made known to us the dream of the king. Daniel praised God. He stopped, got the interpretation, and praised God at that moment. This is an important moment because this sums up this message. Daniel is praising God because of God's wisdom. God knows the secrets of history. God knows where history is going. And why is this relevant? Well, because Nebuchadnezzar, the king on the throne right now, he is evil. And what Daniel is discerning here is this. The king of the world, it isn't Nebuchadnezzar. Who is the king of the world? God is. And God in his providence is orchestrating and directing the flow of human history. God is ultimately the one that is bringing up and establishing down. And this gives Daniel a great deal of peace. And it should give you a great deal of peace that God, only God, is in control. So now we're going to get to the big section. Just follow along. Here we go. Then Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to execute the wise men of Babylon, and said to him, do not execute the wise men of Babylon. Take me to the king, and I will interpret his dream for him. Arioch took Daniel to the king at once and said, I have found a man among the exiles from Judah who can tell the king what his dream means. The king asked Daniel, are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it? Daniel replied, no wise man enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. Your dream and your visions that passed through your mind as you were laying in bed are these. As your majesty was lying there, your mind turned to things to come, and the revealer of mysteries showed you what is going to happen. As for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because I have greater wisdom than everybody else, but so that your majesty may know the interpretation and that may you understand what went through your mind. Your majesty looked, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. While you were watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It struck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were all broken into pieces and became like chaff on a threshing floor in the summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace, but the rock that struck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. Your majesty, you are the king of kings. The God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. In your hands, he has placed all mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds in the sky. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over them all. You are that head of gold. After you, another kingdom will arise inferior to yours. Next, the third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all the others. In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. This is the meaning of the vision of the rock cut out of a mountain, but not by human hands. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to pieces. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid him honor and ordered that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, "Surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and the revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery." That's our scripture today. Now, remember that praise that we stopped and looked at that God gave after God helped him interpret the dream. Who was it about? The God of Daniel, our God. Who is the true king of history? The God of Daniel, our God. Who is the true one with power and wisdom and reveals mysteries about where the world is going? Again, our God. Now, does the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, now does he agree with Daniel? Yes, apparently. He says, "Surely your God is the God of all gods. This is a miracle on its own." Now, what on earth does this have to do with you? We just read a lot about different dreams and the statue and the gold and the clay. What does this have to do with you? So Daniel is determined not to become the culture around him, but swim upstream. He's had a dress like a Babylonian. He's had to learn the language of the Babylonians. He was even given a good government job for the Babylonians. And none of these things are viewed as compromise. But what is viewed as compromise is that it would be for him to give up his true identity as a marked chosen one of God. And then this raises the question, where does he get his energy to swim up these streams of the culture? What fuels Daniel? What's going to fuel you? What's going to fuel Daniel for a lifetime of navigating these tensions of swimming upstream? What's going to fuel you when it's really hard and inconvenient to follow Jesus because it's so counter to what lives here in Southern California or California in general? The vision of Daniel chapter 2 is what's going to fuel him. That's what it is. And knowing this, if you're a note taker, this is our note. The future is well known to God. The future is well known to God. Now, I want you to take a second and imagine you live in Babylon. If you lived in Babylon, who is the king of the world? Nebuchadnezzar. What Daniel comes to realize in chapter 2 is, yes, Nebuchadnezzar is very powerful, but is he actually king of the world? Absolutely not. The true king of the world is the maker of heaven and earth. Ultimately, all human kingdoms are subordinate and accountable to this true king. Whether they know it or not, they're accountable to a much greater king, the God of Daniel and you and I. Okay, but what can you do today with this information? The people that are rulers over your life, the tyrants in your life. Here's the deal. At the time, was Nebuchadnezzar important? Yes, he was. He was important. This dream highlights that he is the head. He is the gold head. And Daniel even says that the king of Babylon is the king of kings, which kind of makes Christians feel a little uncomfortable. But here is the twist. God has established Nebuchadnezzar for such a time. Okay? Now, how does this relate to you? I mean, is this about my boss? I hate my boss. Has God given him power and dominion? Maybe for such a time. We will always fight for a better tomorrow as Christians, but God is in control. We are not. God is in control. Is this about all these leaders and the governments that I cannot stand? Maybe for such a time. Or perhaps maybe it's about us, you and me. How? I don't rule anything. I don't rule anything. My dogs barely let me rule them. They seem to rule me all the time. So what's happening here in this dream? What Nebuchadnezzar was being told here is, yes, he is the leader and he is important for such a time that God has allowed it to be, for such a time. But the future is well known to our God. And get this, there's a temptation for all of us. Maybe you are in work right now, you're working right now, and you've got a little more power under your belt. Maybe you're retired and you have some money and you have some resources and people really respect you. Maybe you've been given more responsibilities at your work if you're working, and maybe you've been given more responsibilities at home, and maybe you kind of start feeling like a god in your own house. I run this place. This is mine. Don't laugh. Maybe, even if it's just an apartment that you rule, and you get a cat, and you're like, I am superior to you, cat. I have dominion over you, cat. And then you realize that that cat is going to rule your life, because that's what cats do. But seriously, maybe you move up the ranks in your job, at your local Applebee's, and you're kind of like, I get to tell people what to do. I get to rearrange their schedule whenever I want to. I deliver the people the food. I control the food. And you think you have power and reign. You're king of kings of Applebee's. But you realize it's not Chili's. Chili's is better. That's what I was trying to say. Power does something to us. Have you ever heard the saying, absolute power to absolutely corrupt? Absolute power to absolutely corrupt. Something happens to us. Something happens. It's this default setting of selfishness. It's the sinfulness of man that we read in God's word. And what Nebuchadnezzar, the biggest and the baddest, is being reminded here that even if he is elevated to this position of immense responsibility and authority, at the end of the day, he's just a king for a kingdom for this time and place. And what you need to remember that you're only the king of kings of Applebee's until they find somebody else, someone more qualified. You're only the king of kings of your apartment until you adopt that cat who rules your life. You might be at the top for the moment. You're the top dog. And it's taken you a long time to get there. And it's been a strenuous trip to get to the very top. But it takes one misstep and you come crumbling down much faster than you ever ascended to the top. However, there is a true King of Kings that the future is well known to because he is God, because he is the King of the universe, the maker of heaven and earth, and he's the one that knows. He knows the future, the past, and the present. That's the Lord and King that we have, that we believe in. Now, I'm finally going to give you some certainties about your future right now. Because the future is made known to us, all of us. The future is made known to us. What the dream showed us is that this king's power is actually not going to be around forever. It's not. The Babylonian Empire that we're talking about today, it lasted a solid 1,000 years. Pretty good. The Roman Empire lasted like half a millennium. Us Americans, around 200 years old. We're not even 250 years old yet. With human beings, we need to be reminded of, and what the scripture is telling us, is that our lives are short. Things are temporary and impermanent. And what the king needed to be reminded of, kingdom after kingdom after kingdom comes and goes, but one thing remains. Listen, you might think you're the hottest hot shot of the world right now, but you won't be around forever. You won't. So what do? This book is trying to install in Daniel and his friends and you and I that the kind of mindset that's going to help us swim upstream, it's the kind of mindset that says, you know, whatever kingdom God's people happen to find themselves in, this isn't how it's always been, and this isn't always how it's going to be. And I find so much joy in the impermanence of that because I know that there is something greater and far beyond that surpasses my understanding of the life that's right in front of me right now. Because Jesus is that King of Kings. That's all that should matter. Thank God that there's more than just this today. Thank God there's more to it. That's the mindset that this dream is trying to cultivate in Daniel and you. What seems to be so permanent and fixed right now in this world, it hasn't always been this way, and it's not always going to be this way. In fact, God is the king of history, and he's orchestrating history towards its goal. Even if we don't understand it, everybody, even if we don't get it, he's orchestrating it towards his goal. And the greatest mistake that you can make, that God's people can ever do, is to ground their true identity in the culture or the world they happen to live in. Because you don't want to ground your identity in something that's impermanent, in something that's so human. Because God, our God, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, I'm going to end with these thoughts. I'm going to go back to the vision, okay? It concludes with that rock. It was the rock that doesn't get dug out by human hands. It's not by human power that the rock comes. The rock comes and just decimates this whole statue in the vision. The statue just crumbles. So what does this rock symbolize? It's the kingdom of God. It's God's reign and God's rule. The true goal of history and where history is leading and how we can know our future is in the full realization of God's reign and God's kingdom in Jesus Christ. And for Daniel, that's where he grounds his identity and his hope. It's in his God. And we're going to inspire Daniel to resist these currents of his cultures. It's by saying, well, I know it's not going to be like this forever. My identity is not going to be defined by the currents that are pushing against me all the time. My true identity is defined by where I trust this world is headed, and that is always the kingdom of God. It is always the kingdom of God. And what does that rock of God's kingdom do to the kingdoms of this world? It annihilates them. It takes them out. something very interesting I want you to know. The book of Daniel is extremely important to Jesus. Extremely important. Jesus uses it all the time. He quotes from it all the time. So what does it mean to say that God's kingdom is going to come and smash the kingdoms of this world? Well, first, Jesus comes and he just smashes and confronts and challenges all the kingdoms in this world from then until forever. Always smashing and confronting and challenging all the culture that we live in. He showed us how to live in this upside down culture. After Jesus finishes this great speech to his disciples in the upper room in the Gospel of John, he says, things are not going to get better. It's going to get really bad from here on out. You're going to have lots of trouble. But then he says, but have peace because I have conquered the world. I have conquered the world. That's Jesus' final words in John 16. I have conquered the world. Through Jesus, the cornerstone, the rock, has smashed death and sin through his resurrection victory. Through that, if we put our faith in him, our future is made known to us, eternity with the King of Kings. That's our future, the King of all kingdoms. Second, when he comes again, Revelation 19, 15 through 16, he will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The true King of Kings will come again. Jesus is the ultimate rule. He has a plan for our lives. He has a plan for future lives. The plan is already in effect. Don't discount that and get swept away by the currents of the culture. Following Jesus can be difficult in today's age, and every age for that matter, but take heart because Jesus has conquered the world. That's what he told us. So when you feel like you're just swimming upstream, you're tired, you're defeated, you're depressed, you don't know what to do in this world that you live in today, you're under the oppressors of your life, the bosses of your life, the rulers of your life, the kings of your life, the governments of your life, maybe your own sinful ruler in your heart, remember where things are headed, where history is headed. You're in God's rule, in God's reign, in God's kingdom. Ground your identity in that. Ground your identity in that hope. Because what's going to motivate you and give you energy for a lifetime of fighting against the currents of the culture? It's being a follower of Jesus. It's all about that hope, knowing you can spend eternity with him. That profound hope that is in Jesus, heaven has already come smashing into this earth. The oppressors of your life, the bosses of your life, the rulers of your life, the kings of your life, the governments of your life, they will come and go. All things go away with time, but one thing remains. One thing remains. That is Christ Jesus. Amen? Let's stand in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now to thank you for your word, for Daniel 2. Thank you for helping us to see what it looks like to go against the currents of the culture. I know how difficult it is. I know how easy it is just to get swept up, lie back, and let the culture just take us where it wants us to go. Lord, you are in control. You know our past. You know our present. And you know our future. Right now, there are crazy things happening in the Middle East. I want to pray for Israel. And everything that we saw through social media or the news last night, we pray for our brothers in Israel. And I know it feels to a lot of us that some bad things are coming. I saw on Twitter last night, World War III trending. For everyone in this room, for everyone online, take heart. Jesus has already conquered the world. He already conquered it. Wherever we're going, he warned us, things aren't going to get better. It's gonna get harder. So when you get fearful and you get anxiety about where this world is headed, ground your identity in Christ. all of us ground our identity in Christ, if you've never accepted Christ into your life and you see all this stuff going on in this world, now's the time. Give your life over. Give your life over to the past, the present, and the future, the Alpha and the Omega. And you will live for eternity with the King of Kings. I pray for anyone in this room that is struggling mentally, that is in pain, that is sick, that needs prayer, they need fellowship and friends, that feel alone, they have someone that they've lost in their life. Lord, I pray over their hearts, and I pray that you just give them comfort and peace to know that you are eternal, and there's something more than what we can see right in front of us. And yes, we are in pain, or we are sick, or we are missing that person. But Lord, we just have to look to you, the rock, the cornerstone that annihilates all the kingdoms, because your kingdom comes out on top. In Jesus Christ's name, we all pray. Amen. Right now, I'm going to invite the praise band up to sing a last song. If you need prayer, our prayer team is ready to go. They will be up front, and they can pray over whatever needs you might have. It's always such a beautiful thing to pray with someone else and lay hands on each other. We're going to be giving out our tithing baskets right now, passing those around. Thank you for so being so generous here to the Bridge Church. I did this in the first service. I'm going to do it the next two. I want to thank our leaders. I want to thank our volunteers that make Sunday happen. I want to thank our worship team. I want to thank everyone that's really stepping up to really help grow this church. We went to 3 services about 7 weeks ago now, 6 or 7 weeks ago, and it's just been such a blessing to see everyone rise up and say, hey, we're going to step up and we're going to try to grow this church, go against the culture, and show the people in Corona and the community a new way to live, a new way of life, and that is through Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Amen? God bless. Have a great week, and be safe out there.
Realize Have a great week. Let's remember to pray for Israel, and God bless you guys. Amen.